preparation of RRB JEE, SSC JEE and other exams like DMRC JEE and State Engineering JEE exams require in-depth knowledge of the subjects. GradeUp, India's largest exam preparation platform, brings to you a dedicated YouTube channel for RRB JEE and SSC JEE aspirants. Subscribe to GradeUp RRB JEE and SSC JEE exam channel today and stay updated for the exam.
Hello friends, I welcome you all on India's largest live e-learning educational platform. In today's session, we are going to discuss some of the important questions and related concepts for your upcoming BARC examination. Now today we are going to discuss the questions related to electromagnetics and some questions for microwave also. Now let us start this session with the first question that we are going to discuss. Just read the question carefully and try to give me the answer as per the given options. Now, let us analyze the given question. In the question, he is saying, for a single turn loop of current as shown in the figure, the magnetic field intensity at the center point P of the semicircular portion will be. He is asking the magnetic field intensity at this point P. Now, at point P, you can define the magnetic field intensity comprising two components. For this component, that is semicircular, I am defining the magnetic field intensity at P as H1 due to semicircular portion. And I am defining H2 due to half of the square loop. If you closely observe the given configuration, this is going to be a half of the square loop, where the length of each side of the square, if it is a full square, is going to be 2 meters. So, total magnetic field is going to be H1 plus H2. Now, the idea is to find H1 and H2 separately and then add them up as per their direction. Now, can you tell me, if this is a circular loop and this is radius A, then what is the magnetic field? It is going to be I upon 2A. This is the magnetic field at the center of the loop due to a single turn current loop. Now, if it is a semicircular loop, if you find it only due to the half of this configuration, that is semicircular loop, then magnetic field at the center, if this radius is A, will be given as I upon 4A. Now, in the problem he has given, the current I as 8 ampere and the radius is 1 meter. So, it is going to be 8 divided by 4 into 1. So, it is going to be 2 ampere per meter. Now, this is, you have calculated H1. Now, let us try to calculate H2. Now, suppose you have a square loop like this. This is center O. Now, just focus this part, this length of one of the side of the square loop. Now, this, for this portion, I am defining angle alpha 1 as this and angle alpha 2 as this. Now, what is going to be the magnetic field intensity at the center O? It is going to be H is equal to I upon 4 pi rho, and this is going to be cos alpha 2 minus cos alpha 1. where alpha 1 is the angle made by lower end of the current filament and alpha 2 is the angle made by the upper end of the current filament to the point where you want to find the magnetic field. Now, if you closely observe here, definitely alpha 1 is 90 degree and alpha 2 is going to be 45 degree. Now, if you put the values, then H is going to be I upon, and suppose this square side length is A, so what is going to be this perpendicular distance? A by 2. So 4 pi rho is going to be the perpendicular distance from the wire or the current filament. So this is going to be A by 2. What is cos alpha 2? Cos alpha 2 is cos 45 degrees. So it is going to be 1 upon root 2. And cos alpha 1, cos 90 is 0. So you will get H as 1 upon, it is going to be 2 root 2 pi A. Now, you please understand that this is 1/8 part of the total square loop. Similar magnetic fields are going to be produced by such 8 equal parts, and the direction is going to be added up because the current direction is going to be such that the magnetic field due to each individual section is going to be added up. So, the total magnetic field due to the whole square loop is going to be 8 times H that we have calculated. It is 1 upon 2 root 2 pi A. 1 upon 2 root 2 pi A. So, this is going to be 2 root 2. Sorry, this is I actually. It must be I here. 2 root 2, because 2 will cancel 4 and root 2 will cancel 2 root 2, I upon pi A. This is due to A is square loop of side A. But in the question, you have to find out the magnetic field due to half of the square loop. So, this is going to be how much? Can you tell me what is H2? H2 is going to be 1 by 2, 2 root 2, I upon pi A, or it is going to be root 2 I upon pi A. I is given as 8 pi, and this length A is going to be 2 meters, because if it would have been a whole square, the length of each side is going to be 2 meters. So, this is going to be 2. Now, if you simplify this, this is going to be 4 root 2 upon pi. Now, what is going to be the total magnetic field H? Total magnetic field H is going to be H1 we have calculated as 2 ampere per meter. So, this is going to be 2 ampere per meter, and what we have calculated as H2? H2 we have calculated as 4 root 2 upon pi ampere per meter. 4 root 2 upon pi ampere per meter. If you simplify this value, then you will get 3.8 amperes per meter. This is going to be your answer. But the options given are having two options with 3.8 value. Now, you have to calculate the direction of magnetic field also. For that purpose, you have to apply the right-hand rule. If the current direction is this, if you apply your finger's movement in the direction of current, then the magnetic field is going to be in the direction of your thumb. It means the direction of H is going to be inward. So, what is the correct option? D is going to be the correct option. I hope it is clear. Now, let us go to the next question we have to discuss. Let's read this question carefully and try to answer the correct option. Now, all those candidates who are comfortable with this question, just do the question, and others, please focus on your screen. It is given that a current free region of relative permeability 1, the magnetic scalar potential is given as this much. So, magnetic scalar potential is giving you x square y plus y square x plus z. Now, he is asking the magnitude of the magnetic field density at this point. What is magnetic field density? Magnetic field density is nothing but B. And you must be knowing that you can define the magnetic field intensity as gradient of the scalar magnetic potential as you define the electric field intensity in terms of scalar electric potential minus gradient of V. Similarly, for magnetic field, you are defining minus gradient of Vm, where Vm is the scalar magnetic potential. Now, before you solve this question, it is very important to understand what is actually the physical interpretation, significance of this scalar magnetic potential. This scalar magnetic potential is nothing but the MMF or N into I. If you apply the Ampere's law, closed line integral H dot dl is equal to Ni. So, this Ni we are defining as the scalar magnetic potential. Now, another very important point here is that this MMF is going to be only exist. MMF can only exist in current free regions. That is why in this question, he has clearly mentioned that it is a current free region. Then only you can find this scalar magnetic potential, and then you can apply this equation. Now, if you see, this Nebla operator is going to be del upon del x Ax plus del upon del y Ay plus del upon del z Az. And if you find the gradient of the given magnetic scalar potential, then del upon del x of this is going to be 2xy plus y square, and this is going to be 0. This is going to be Ax plus del upon del y, it is going to be x square plus 2xy Ay plus del upon del z 0, 0 and 1. So, this is going to be simply 1az. Now, the first thing you have to calculate is you have just found the gradient of Vm. So, what is going to be H? It is going to be minus of gradient of Vm. So, this is going to be minus. Now, just put x, y, z is equal to 1 because you have to find the magnetic field at this point. So, this is going to be minus 2 plus 1 Ax minus 1 plus 2 Ay plus, minus 1 Az. Now, if you want, then you can calculate the value, the magnitude of this H field. So, this is going to be how much? This is going to be, what is this? 3 square. This is again 3 square plus, this is 1 square, 1 by 2. If you find this value of H, then you will get 2 square plus 1 by 2. It is going to be mu naught mu r h. Now, mu r is given as 1. What is mu naught? It is going to be 4 pi into 10 to the power minus 7. And if you put the magnitude of h with this value, then you will get the magnitude of the magnetic field density as 5.5 micro tesla. So, what is the correct option? B is going to be the correct option. I hope it is clear to all of you. Now, let us move to the next question that we have to discuss. Let's read this question carefully and try to answer it. Now, he has given you the electric field expression for a medium which is characterized by conductivity is equal to 0, mu is equal to mu naught, and epsilon is equal to 4 epsilon naught. If you compare this then you will get mu r is equal to 1 and epsilon r is equal to 4 and sigma is given as 0. Now, if you see this electric field intensity expression, you can very easily identify that omega is going to be 10 to the power 8 radian per second, okay, and you know that phase velocity Vp is going to be omega upon beta. Now, the, what is this Vp? It is going to be 1 upon under root mu into epsilon, but you know that it is going to be mu naught mu r epsilon naught epsilon r under root, or you can define it as under root mu naught epsilon naught 1 upon under root epsilon r, or you can write beta as omega into mu naught epsilon naught epsilon r, you can write. And what is this under root mu naught epsilon naught? This is going to be omega under root epsilon r upon c, that is the speed of light in vacuum. Now, just put the values. Omega you have calculated as 10 to the power 8. What is under root epsilon r? Epsilon r is 4. So, under root epsilon r is going to be 2. And what is the speed of light? 3 into 10 to the power 8. So, beta is going to be 2 by 3. So, what is the correct option? A. A is going to be the correct option. Now, let us see the next question that we have to discuss. Let me correct this question. For this part, this angle is theta 4. Now, this is region 1, region 2, and this is region 3 with mu 3. Now, if you apply the magnetic field boundary refraction equality, then it is going to be mu 1 tan theta 1 is equal to mu 2 tan theta 2. This is for boundary between region 1 and region 2. Similarly, if you apply the same equation for this boundary between region 2 and region 3, so, this is going to be mu 2 tan theta 3 is equal to mu 3 tan theta 4. This is for the boundary between region 2 and region 4. Now, you must be knowing that theta 2 is going to be equal to theta 3. Theta 2 is equal to theta 3. So, if you combine these two equations, you will get mu 1 tan theta 1 is equal to mu 3 tan theta 4. Now, he is asking that theta 4 is going to be independent of what? So, if you see for this equation, for theta 4, there is no term for mu 2. So, definitely, theta 4, it is going to be independent of mu 2 only. I hope it is clear. Now, let us go to the next question. Just read this question carefully and try to solve it. All the people who are comfortable with this, just solve this, and other candidates, just go with the analysis that I am going to discuss with you. Now, in the question he is saying, an electromagnetic wave has electric field intensity in the phasor form as ES is equal to 4AZ minus JAX, and this is e raised to the power minus J beta Y. Now, this EM wave is incident on a perfect conductor at Y is equal to 0. Suppose this is y is equal to 0. Now, can you tell me the direction of wave propagation? If you see, for this incident wave, the direction of wave propagation is positive y direction. This wave is propagating in the positive y direction. So, if this is y greater than 0 and this is y less than 0, you can assume, then this wave is actually traveling in this direction. This is ESI, that is ESI is the incident electric wave, you can say, EM wave. Now, he is asking what will be the polarization of the reflected wave. So, first thing we have to calculate is the expression for the reflected wave. Now, if this is the incident wave, can you tell me what is the expression for the reflected wave? It is going to be the reflection coefficient times the given electric field e raised to the power minus j beta y. Now, if you see, this is going to be minus y. Because if the incident wave is in the positive y direction, then the reflected wave will be in the negative y direction. So, for the negative y direction, you have to put minus y. Now, what is this reflection coefficient? This reflection coefficient is going to be minus 1 for reflected wave, for conductor boundary, because it is given in the question on a perfect conductor. For a perfect conductor, this reflection coefficient is going to be minus 1. So, what is going to be the expression for reflected wave? It is going to be ERS is equal to 4 minus az plus j ax e raised to the power j beta y. Now, you can write the electric field expression using the time harmonics. It is going to be E is going to be the real 4 minus az plus j ax, and this is going to be cos omega t plus j sin omega t, cos omega t plus j sin omega t, and this is going to be the e j beta y. Now, if you simplify this, then you will get the expression for the reflected wave E as 4 minus cos omega t. This is going to be az minus sin omega t ax, and this is going to be e raised to the power j beta y. Now, if you see this expression, the magnitude for the z and x component is going to be same. If you see the z component magnitude, it is going to be 4 minus 4 cos omega t, and for the x component, it is minus 4 sin omega t. It means you can say the magnitude of z component and x component are same. And what is the phase difference between them? The phase difference is pi by 2. It means this reflected wave is going to be circularly polarized. Now, you have to identify whether this reflected wave is right hand circularly polarized or left hand circularly polarized. Now, if you find angle tan theta, it is going to be minus, this is going to be minus 4 sine omega t upon minus 4 cos omega t, or you can write it tan omega t, or theta is equal to omega t. Now suppose if this is z direction and this is x direction and this is the locus of the tip of the E phasor, like this, this angle we are representing as theta. Now if you are increasing the time, if you are increasing the time, then theta is going to increase. If you are increasing the time, theta is going to increase. If theta is increasing, it means the locus of E is moving in this direction. Now what is the direction of wave propagation? The direction of wave propagation is minus AY direction. Okay. Now if you have to find out the left hand or right hand circular polarization, what is the idea? The idea is, if you place your thumb, left hand thumb, in the direction of wave propagation and the fingers are moving in the direction of time as advancement. Time advancement means in the direction of movement of the locus of the tip of E phasor, then it is going to be left hand circularly polarized. So what is the polarization of the reflected wave for the given problem? It is going to be left hand circularly polarized. A is going to be the correct option. I hope it is clear. Now let us see the next question that we have to discuss. Now for this question, I am giving you the diagram. Please focus here. This is given as Z naught is equal to 30 ohms. This is given as Z naught is equal to 60 ohms. And this is given as Z naught is equal to 30 root 2 ohms. And this ZL is given as 30 ohms. Now the lengths are given as this is equal to lambda by 4. And for this, the length is given as lambda by 8. Now, in the question, he is asking the all the transmission line sections are lossless and you have to find the voltage standing wave ratio on the 60 ohm line. What is the 60 ohm line here in this diagram? This is the 60 ohm line. Now, for this line, if you want to calculate the voltage standing wave ratio, you must be knowing this Z in, because this Z in is going to be ZL for this part of the transmission line of 60 ohms characteristic impedance. Now, first thing we are going to do is, first I will find the Z in 1 for this section lambda by 4, then I will find Z in 2 for this lambda by 8, and then I will draw the equivalent circuit. And then we will see how we are going to calculate the voltage standing wave ratio for the 60 ohm section of the line. Now, you must be knowing this, that Z in is given as Z naught ZL plus J Z naught tan beta L upon Z naught plus J ZL tan beta L. Now, first I am going to find Z in 1. What is the length of this section? Lambda by 4. So, what is going to be beta L? 2 pi by lambda. What is L? It is lambda by 4. So, this is going to be pi by 2. And what is ZL for this part? ZL is 30 ohms. And what is Z naught? 30 root 2 ohms. Now, if you find the Z in 1, this is going to be Z naught, and because beta L is going to be pi by 2, it means tan beta L is going to be infinite. So what is going to be Z in 1? It is going to be Z naught. This is going to be Z naught upon ZL. J will get cancelled out. So this is going to be Z naught square upon ZL. So Z in 1, I am writing here, Z in 1 is going to be Z naught square upon ZL. What is Z naught? Z naught for this lambda by 4 section is 30 root 2. So this is going to be 30 into root 2 into 30 into root 2 divided by, what is ZL? ZL is 30. So if you simplify this, then this is going to be 60 ohms. Z in 1 is going to be 60 ohms. That is the first thing. Now I am going to calculate Z in 2. What is Z in 2? It is for lambda by 8. So what is going to be beta L? Beta is 2 pi by lambda and L is lambda by 8. So this is going to be pi by 4. I hope it is clear. Now if you put it here in the equation, then Z in 2 is going to be Z naught. What is ZL here? Please see. What is ZL here? This is going to be, ZL is going to be 0 because it is short circuit, nothing else, short circuit. So ZL is going to be 0. So ZL is going to be 0. Now if you put ZL is equal to 0 plus J Z naught, what is tan beta L? Tan beta L is tan pi by 4, that is 1. And what is Z naught? Z naught will come here plus J ZL. Now ZL tan beta L, tan beta L is going to be 1 and ZL is going to be 0. So this is going to be how much? It is going to be J times Z naught. Now what is Z naught? For this lambda by 8 section, Z naught is 30 ohms. So this is going to be J 30 ohms. Now if you draw the equivalent circuit is going to be something like this. For this part, it is going to be J 30, and for this part, it is going to be 60 ohms. So if you want to find the Z in or Z load for these two sections combined, so it is going to be how much? It is going to be 1 is going to be ZL, and that is going to be 60 plus J 30. Now what is going to be the reflection coefficient for the 60 ohm line? Reflection coefficient for the 60 ohm line, this is going to be ZL minus Z naught upon ZL plus Z naught. What is ZL? 60 plus J 30 minus 60 divided by ZL is 60 plus J 30 plus 60. 60 is going to be cancelled. This is J 30 upon 120 plus J 30. If you simplify this, the magnitude of the reflection coefficient is going to be 1 upon under root 4 square plus 1. So this is going to be 1 upon under root 17. Now what is going to be voltage standing wave ratio? This is going to be 1 plus reflection coefficient, 1 minus reflection coefficient. So this is going to be 1 upon under root 17 upon 1 minus 1 upon under root 17. If you simplify this, then you will get 1.64 as the final answer. So what is the correct option? B. I hope it is clear to all of you. Just go through this quickly and check with your calculation whether you are getting the correct result or not. Now let us see the next question that we have to discuss. Now this question is related to the scattering parameters or the scattering matrix. For a two-port network, in this question the scattering matrix is given and is asking about the nature of the network. Now you must be knowing this, that for a lossless network, it must follow the unity property, which in one way you can write as is equal to 1. Now just check with the given S parameters whether you are getting it or not. What is S11? S11 is given as 0.2 angle 0 degree, and what is S21? It is given as 0.9 angle 90 degree. Now if you see 0.2 square plus 0.9 square is not equal to 1. It means the network is not lossless. It means it is lossy. And about the reciprocal property, you must have S12 is equal to S21. Now, if you see S12 and S21 are same, so this is going to be reciprocal. It means the given two-port network is not lossless but reciprocal. So, what is the correct option? C. It is not lossless but reciprocal. Now, let us go to the next question. For this question, I am giving you the circuit. This is 50 ohms, and for both parts, Z naught is also given as 50 ohms. This is the network given, and is asking you to find the S parameters for the given two-port network. Now your scattering matrix is going to be S11, S12, S21, S22. And how you are going to calculate S11? It is going to be ZL parallel Z naught minus Z naught upon ZL parallel Z naught plus Z naught, because these are going to be the reflection coefficients. The diagonal parameters are nothing but the reflection coefficients. You must be knowing this. So S11, what is ZL and Z naught? ZL Z naught is going to be 50 and 50. So this is going to be minus 1 by 3. Similarly, if you find S22, you will get minus 1 by 3. Now what is S12 or S21? This is going to be 2 times ZL parallel Z naught upon ZL parallel Z naught plus Z naught. If you simplify this, then you will get 2 by 3. So, what is the correct option? I think it should be 1 by 3. Then you will get the correct answer. So, C is going to be the correct option. I hope it is clear. Now, let us go to the next question that we have to discuss. Just read this question carefully and try to answer it. Now, this question is related to the rectangular waveguide. He is saying the phase velocity of an electromagnetic wave propagating in a hollow metallic rectangular waveguide for TE, I think there is some mistake, it should be TE10, let it be TE10, because for rectangular waveguide, it should be TE10 or TE01, is. Now, the options are A, B, C, D. Now, please try to understand, for any propagating mode, you know that phase velocity is going to be greater than c and it is going to be greater than group velocity. So what is the correct option? D. The phase velocity is going to be greater than the velocity of light in free space. Now here it is very important to understand what is this phase velocity. This phase velocity is actually the velocity at which loci of the constant phase propagated down the waveguide. And it is given as V dash upon under root 1 minus FC upon F square, where V dash is 1 upon mu epsilon and FC is the cutoff frequency and F is the operating frequency. Similarly, you have to understand the group velocity also. It is the velocity at which the resultant repeated, reflected wave travels down the waveguide. And it is given as 1 upon del beta upon del omega, or you can write V dash under root 1 minus FC upon F whole square, where FC is the cutoff frequency and F is the operating frequency. Now, let us see the next question. Just read this question carefully and try to answer it. Now, in this question, he is saying the magnetic field, it is not among, it is the along the propagation direction inside a rectangular waveguide with the cross section shown in figure. This is the cross section of the waveguide, rectangular waveguide shown in the figure. Hz is given as 3 cos this much x cos this much y cos t minus beta z. Now, if you compare the given equation for this Hz with the standard equation, very easily you can write that beta x is going to be 2.094 into 10 to the power 2 and beta y is going to be 2.618 into 10 to the power 2. And this is going to be your omega, 6.283 into 10 to the power 10. Now, if you see, you must be knowing this formula to find the beta, total beta as omega square upon c square minus beta x square plus beta y square. Now, here c is going to be 3 into 10 to the power 8. Just put the values and you will get beta as J261, where you are getting the beta as imaginary. Now, because you are getting the beta as imaginary, the given mode is non-propagating. Non-propagating means for the phase velocity for the given mode is going to be 0 if it is not propagating. So, what is the correct answer? D. I hope it is clear. Now, let us go to the next question that we have to discuss. Now, this is a problem related to array antenna. Just read the question carefully and try to answer it. Now, it is saying in the question that in a uniform linear array, 4 isotropic radiating elements are spaced lambda by 4 apart. The progressive phase shift between the elements required for forming the main beam at 60% of the end fire. The condition is end fire. It is an end fire array. So, what is the formula for the antenna array? Xi is going to be beta d cos theta plus alpha. Now, this d is given as lambda by 4. And for end fire, this xi must be 0. For end fire condition, if you put the values, this is going to be 0 is equal to 2 pi by lambda, d is lambda by 4, theta is given as cos 60 degree plus alpha. Now, if you simplify this, you will get alpha is equal to minus pi by 4. What is the correct answer? Phase shift, it is going to be C option. C is going to be the correct option. Now, let us see the next question. In this question, he is asking, an antenna in free space receives 2 microwatts of power when the incident electric field is 20 millivolts per meter RMS. The effective aperture of the antenna is. Now, the aperture area is defined as power received divided by the pointing vector of the incident wave . Now this power received is 2 into 10 to the power minus 6 because it is microwatts. And pointing vector is going to be mod E square upon eta naught. Now, this is going to be 2 into 10 to the power minus 6. What is mod E square? Mod E square is going to be 20 into 10 to the power minus 3 square. And this eta naught is nothing but 120 pi. So, if you simplify this, then you will get the answer for aperture area as 1.885 meter square. So, C is going to be the correct option. I hope it is clear. Now, let us see the next question that we have to discuss. The next question is related to the traveling wave tube. He is saying a helical traveling wave tube has a diameter of 2 mm. With 50 turns per centimeter, calculate the anode voltage at which the traveling wave tube can be operated for the useful gain. Now, first thing for this question you have to find is the pitch. The pitch is going to be 1 upon turns per centimeters. So, this is going to be 1 upon 50, it is going to be centimeter per turn. Now, you know what is the axial phase velocity. The axial phase velocity Vp is given as C into pitch upon circumference. Now, this C is nothing but 3 into 10 to the power 8. Pitch you have calculated as 1 upon 50, and this circumference is going to be pi into d, 2 pi r or pi into d. So, this is given as 2 mm diameter, and this is going to be 10 to the power minus 2 because it is in centimeters and this is in mm. Now if you calculate, you will get Vp as 0.95 into 10 to the power 7 meter per second. Now if this is the axial phase velocity, how you are going to relate the anode voltage? This Vp is going to be 0.593 into 10 to the power 6, and this is going to be anode voltage. Now if you put the values, you will get the anode voltage V naught as 259.2 volts. So what is the correct option? A. I hope it is clear. Now let us see the next question. Let's read this question carefully and try to solve it. Now this question is for X band cylindrical magnetron, which is having the following operating parameter: anode voltage as this much, beam current this much, magnetic flux density B naught this much, radius of the cathode cylinder, that is A, is equal to 5 centimeters, radius of vein H to center is 10 centimeters. He is asking you to find the calculate the cutoff magnetic flux density for a fixed V naught. Now you must be knowing this Hall cutoff magnetic equation. Which says that beta OC is going to be 8 V naught E by M 1 by 2, and this is going to be B 1 minus A upon B square. Now all the values are given here. V naught is given as 28 kilovolts. E and M standard values you can take. A is given as 5 centimeters and B is given as 10 centimeters. If you put the values, you will get the required value of BOC, that is 14.495 milliwebers per meter square. So what is the correct option? C. I hope it is clear. So my friend, with this I am concluding this session here. But before I conclude this session, let me tell you that right now we are running an exclusive offer on this auspicious occasion of Holi, that is a spin to win up to 30% discount on all the live courses and green cards. This is a limited period offer, and I think if you are finding this Grade Up Vision 2021 second batch that we have just started worthy enough, just go through the free trial. All the candidates, I must suggest you that you must start the free trial. This is very, very important. Then only you can understand the kind of impact we are creating right now among the students with this Vision 2021 batch. After the successful launching of the first batch, the admission has already closed for that, and we have just few days back we have started the second batch, and the response is really very, very good, and I thank students for their overwhelming response even for the second batch. But I must tell you, all those candidates who have not joined till now, you must start the free trial. Then only you can understand the kind of impact we are creating in the lives of the students. This is just something on different occasions we are offering you, but that is secondary. The most important thing is you must go and start the free trial. Then only you can understand the effective way in which we are delivering the content for your upcoming examination, whether it is GATE or Engineering Services examination. So thank you so much, all the candidates. I wish you all the best for your exams. Definitely we'll be meeting again on the same platform with some more interesting concepts and questions. Thank you so much for your time. I wish you all the best. Happy Holi to all of you. Enjoy with your family on this auspicious occasion. Take care. We'll meet again. Thank you so much. Prep smart, score better, go grade up. Happy Holi. Thank you so much.